Our next storyteller is James Peterson.
I have not given much thought to immigration in my entire life. On my mother's side, I am a 14th generation American. Her family came to America in 1560 when King George emptied the prisons of debtors, poachers, and horse thieves. A good recipe for basic America. All that meant is that after 14 generations, I couldn't date anyone in Georgia because they're all related to me. On my dad's side of the family, my grandfather and grandmother immigrated to America from Denmark. And my grandfather was a janitor at Northwestern. And my father, the son of a janitor, graduated from Northwestern. And I'm the son of a son of a janitor, and I sometimes teach at Northwestern. And that's the American dream in two generations.
Wow.
I had read some things, something that stayed with me all my life, that borders do not exist in nature. Nature has boundaries, obstacles, oceans, rivers, mountains, and men brave enough to cross them. Borders exist only in the minds of men, 6 feet above the ground, and nothing good has ever come from that idea. So I hadn't thought about immigration until this happened, and this is my story. I heard a champagne cork pop. I turned, and there she was. Every cell in my body went on point. Long strands of DNA drew back and released an error. And the voice of God, or whatever actor was playing God in 1983, said, "You will bear this woman's child." So I turned to my friends and said, "Did you guys put LSD in the punch?" I turned and looked, same response. Every cell on point, long strands of DNA stretched taut and released, and a voice in my head said, "You will bear this woman's child." It made no sense. She wasn't even my type. If it could be said that I had a type, I could walk into a room, find the woman at the edge of a nervous breakdown, and find that sexually attractive. I had dated a blonde and a brunette, and they were complicated. And this woman was a redhead, freckles. She looked happy, untroubled. And I just did a basic checklist. Where was I? I was on a mountaintop, 10,000 feet. It was New Year's Eve. There was a full moon, and we were about to ski down the mountain in a torchlight parade. And I thought, you need someone at 10,000 feet, New Year's Eve, full moon, torchlight parade. There's not a whole bunch about my life I had to explain. So I walked up to her and said, pointing to the champagne, "For me." We skied down the mountain, and at midnight, we kissed. It should have been easy, but the accent that I thought was English was South African. I don't know if you know this, but if you grow up on the wrong side of the equator, down under in one of the Commonwealth countries, you take a walk out. You save all of your money and buy a plane ticket and leave and work your way around the world. And this woman had left. She worked at a bank in England, worked for a modeling agency. She worked in a fishing camp in Alaska. And when I met her, was working at a ski lodge in Utah. And somewhere along the line, when crossing from Alaska, crossing the Canada-Union border, someone had neglected to stamp her passport correctly. So when she went to renew her visa, they said, no, you're here illegally. You have to, and she begged and pleaded, you can leave in 3 months. So we had 3 months to affect this plan. Not to actually conceive and have a child, but to decide if I could persuade her that this moment was real. There were obstacles. I lived in Chicago. So the first time she came here, it was one of those wonderful Chicago days where it was negative 40 degrees windchill. You stepped out of the apartment and your tears froze. But I said, no big problem. She was a knitter, layers. We could get over this. Another problem. I worked for Playboy, and the magazine I worked for was banned in South Africa. And I had given the future mother of my children a book that I had written. She had sent it home. And her mother, of course, looked at it and said, the man who wrote this book is ugly, evil, and depraved. And Sue called him out and said, no, he's not ugly. Sue got a job working for the South African consulate because it seemed to promise a diplomatic visa. But you cannot get a visa if you are already in the country. You have to leave the country and apply. And so that was the first interaction with immigration, and it went well. We went to Bermuda for the weekend and had a wonderful time. She got the visa and came back. But then the very reason she had left South Africa, the politics, was also the reason she could not work at the consulate. She just could not stand some of the decision making there. So she quit, which meant she didn't have the visa, she had to leave the country. So we said, okay, maybe we could get it. What do you want to do with your life? I'd like to go to college. Okay, apply to Roosevelt, and she did. She had to leave the country to get the student visa to Roosevelt. But it was okay. She also, we'd been living together for 9 months or so, and she needed to go back home to see if she could give up her country for me. Easy choice. So she flew home and made up her mind and sent me a picture of herself from like fifth grade, 10-year-old picture, and I looked at this face and I wanted that face in my future. I wanted this woman's child. And so I called her up and said, I want your child. She said, well, does this mean we're getting married? If you insist, it's not a requirement in my country. And then the question was where? So we decided to meet halfway. And we got married in Greece. Which may have been the first democracy on the planet, but it was also the first bureaucracy. And we went through weeks, a week of paperwork, and then persuaded the mayor of the town on Santorini to perform the ceremony. We didn't understand a word of Greek. Her maid of honor was the waitress from a restaurant across the street. Mine was the guy who ran the trolley car. And we sat there, and we're married in a language we did not understand. This mayor, whose face looked like it was right off a Greek coin, said, do you, and then the trolley driver would translate, do you promise to give up the free life forever? Do you promise to raise your children to take care of old people? Okay, that's Greek social security. You understand that her family problems are your family problems. Okay. Do you promise to be lucky for life? And so now we're married, and we had discussed this, and so I went back to the United States, and she took her backpack and continued her working away around. She took 6 more weeks to go around Europe. She saw Denmark and stuff. I had 6 weeks at home to get used to the idea of being married without that nagging presence next to me all the while. And then she came home and went to school. There were other obstacles. She had refused to let me meet her parents until I had table manners. Her parents were of English descent. Her mother was very proper. So we worked on table manners and went to South Africa for Christmas. And I'm sitting at the table. I'm about to put the butter on when an alarm went off in the house next door. And suddenly the air was full of guns. My father-in-law and brother-in-law, went to a gun safety and pulled out handguns. My wife's cousin reached into a bag and pulled out a sawed-off shotgun. And they went off to see what was going on next door. I had a butter knife. I'm not stupid. You don't take a butter knife to a gunfight. But I followed them. There was no intruder. And that night we slept in her childhood bedroom, which had bars on the window and a jailmade steel door at the end of her hall that her father locked every night to keep the family safe. And at that moment, I realized I had married her family's problems. I had married her country. She would never be able to leave that country. That's who she was. And we would have to deal with that. There are 30 years of stories about that. But we came back to the United States. And I said, okay, you're about to graduate. We should make the child I've been waiting for. So we went to Utah, the same mountain we had invested, and did what people do to make a child. And 9 months, 11 days, and 32 hours of labor later, the nurse put this creature into my hands, this little loaf of bread with fingers. And I held her, and out of nowhere, I sang, I once had a girl, or should I say, she once had me. This creature had made me a father. Now, my first thought wasn't, wow, I made an American. My first thought was, I made a miracle. We made a miracle. And in the past few years, I've heard the term an anchor baby. And except for a little bit of paperwork, my daughter would have been an anchor baby. And that's what I think of her as. She is my heart walking around in the open. She anchored my soul. And last year, September 27th, she delivered a child, my first grandchild, and she made me a grandfather. Does this stuff ever end? But that's my immigration story, is that we've had to fight paperwork, bureaucratic nonsense to make this happen, and it finally happened. And that's my future.